The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
The Nicole Sandler Show. Questioning authority daily. And that could be the very reason why YouTube is upset. Hey, YouTube. The music bed you hear beneath my voice is from a broadcast sound library that I pay for and have the receipts. So I've got your copyright violation right here. And now, here's Nicole.
Ah, here I am. Hello, and welcome to a Wednesday. It's Wednesday, right? Yeah, because yesterday was Tuesday. It was the first in the nation primary, the first official primary contest of the 2020 presidential election season. And the winner is, I gotta get that drum roll. Anyway, Bernie Sanders. Yeah. It's so frustrating. So yesterday, Yesterday, after the show, I'm in the living room watching TV, unwinding after the program, and I made the mistake. I know, I'm a glutton for punishment. What can I tell you? I turned on MSNBC, and there's Chuck Todd doing his thing with, you know, we've talked about this before, and now that the impeachment stuff is over, at least for now, I want to get back to the experiment that I talked about a month or so ago, where I want to enlist your help. So if you're interested in helping me go through a week, just a Monday through Friday, of MSNBC, throughout the day, starting at 6 a.m., going to midnight, and detailing who their guests are. Because my contention is, and we've talked about this before, that MSNBC has turned into the Never Trumper channel, right? They have a plethora of guests that are Republicans or, quote, former Republicans who are Never Trumpers. And that's who they've turned the programming over to. So it's a lot of, you know, Joe Scarboroughs and Nicole Wallace's. Now, I actually happen to like Nicole Wallace because I think she's pretty honest, which is, you know, an unusual trait for a Republican, but I think she's a former Republican. So I think she does a decent job. But in terms of the guest bookings, I don't know that any of the hosts have control over the guests they have. Regardless, I want to start keeping track. So if you either do watch MSNBC at any given time during the day, there are certain shows you watch each day, let me know, because I want to enlist your help. We'll give assignments out where we'll each cover a few hours, I hope, and keep track, do a spreadsheet over the course of a week, and find out who the guests are, because I really want to do an analysis of it. And I don't have the the mental, what's the word I'm looking for? Clarity, perhaps, to sit through an entire day of MSNBC, even if it's, you know, DVRing the thing and fast forwarding through it. It's too much. My psyche is already kind of fragile at the moment. So if you want to help, I know Diane Russell in the YouTube chat room watches some shows. In fact, she emailed me when I first brought it up a few months ago and already started keeping track. I would like to start this on Monday of next week. So if you want to help, please, am I aware that on Monday, PV reran my show with the Middle Eastern spokeswoman from 2015? No, I wasn't aware of that. Thanks, Rec 58 in the YouTube chat room. I had no idea. You know, I don't do a show on Mondays, mostly because when I came back after my, I'm all over the place, I apologize. When I came back after being, going on hiatus to deal with lung cancer a few years ago, I came back and I decided to just do the hours that Progressive Voices carried the show. So it was Tuesday through Friday from, you know, and so we're working on changing that. We'll see. I don't even know at this point. I'll tell you, after this past week, I'll tell you, I have moments when I think, why the hell am I doing this? I'm killing myself. Not literally, but figuratively, it does take a toll. And, you know, I suffer from depression and I'm not having an easy go of it. Last night helped a little bit. But so anyway, back to this. If you want to participate in the audit, as it were, of MSNBC, please send me an email, Nicole@NicoleSandler.com. Let me know what shows you regularly watch on MSNBC, and I'll, you know, try not to assign anybody a program that you don't usually watch, but we'll divvy it up, and the hours that you guys don't cover, I'll record on the DVR, and I'll do the fast-forward thing. Somebody mentioned, oh, well, you can get it off the web. No, they don't post everything on the web, so it really is going to take us monitoring it. But so if you want to join in my little experiment or audit, again, send me an email, Nicole@NicoleSandler.com, and we'll divvy up the day to watch MSNBC and keep track of just who their guests are over the course of a week. And actually, I'm thinking we should do Monday through Sunday because, oh boy, they're retooling their weekends. And I confess, I've always, for the last couple of years anyway, sung the praises of Ali Velshi. Well, this weekend, you know, I don't sleep. So I'm up at 8 o'clock in the morning when Ali Velshi is now on Saturdays and Sundays. And I called him out. This past weekend was a Pete love fest. I'm guessing that next weekend's going to be an Amy love fest. But we went back and forth on Twitter, had a little bit of a Twitter argument, as I want to do from time to time. Anyway, it's neither here nor there. Let me know if you want to watch. And those of you who don't watch it, no worries, no pressure here. I'm not trying to get anyone to watch MSNBC. In fact, so what I started telling you was yesterday afternoon after the show, I went inside to unwind, imbibe in some medical, I live in Florida, it's legal, medical marijuana. It's how I sort of calm down after the show, relax. And I made the mistake of turning on MSNBC. And I saw something that made me, you know, with the DVR, you can always back it up. Well, I had no way to dub off this segment. So I pulled out my phone and I videotaped it because I couldn't believe what I heard. Actually, I could believe it because it's MSNBC and they're doing what they've been doing. So they're shuck-toed with this woman, Adrienne Elrod. So, you know, I mentioned it's all like the Never Trumpers. It's the Never Trumpers, and it's the former Hillary Clinton campaign staffers. Okay, that's who their panelists are. That's who the bulk of their pundits are. So they're shuck-toed along with, her name is Adrienne Elrod, I think, and she worked on Hillary Clinton's campaign 4 years ago. And I'm just going to play for you. It's like 90 seconds, so it's not that long of a clip. The first part is this Adrienne Elrod woman explaining to us that we need a real Democrat to be the candidate. Yeah. And then Chuck Todd steps in to tell us what Bernie Sanders needed to get. Remember, this is before the results came in last night. What Bernie Sanders needed to get in terms of his share of the votes in New Hampshire in order to be the, quote, legitimate front runner. I couldn't make this stuff up if I tried. So here we go. From yesterday, MSNBC.
Super Tuesday and it comes down to Sanders v. Bloomberg, there's got to be a third alternative. And I think that if Amy Klobuchar or Elizabeth Warren or even perhaps Joe Biden can stay in the race, can raise the funds necessary, then they could be that third choice. I mean, I'm from the South and I'll tell you, there are a lot of people who are not keen on Bernie Sanders right now, but a lot of people who are not quite ready to wrap their heads around Mike Bloomberg. They wish that Joe Biden had done better. They're looking for a different choice, but they have not quite settled on who that is. And I just think, given the fact that Mike Bloomberg is a former Republican and Democrat, and Bernie Sanders is still labeled as a Democratic Socialist, there's got to be an actual Democrat, somebody who's been a true-blood Democrat for almost their entire life who sticks around in this race.
James Pendel, is there expectations for Bernie that are unfair here? I mean, should a win be a win?
He won by 22 points last time.
They're going to argue a win's a win. Some of us are going to say, hey, he didn't break third.
I think 30 is the over-under number. Absolutely. I'd be shocked If he got more than 35, I would be shocked if he got
a big deal
under 25 at that point. Yeah, it would be a huge deal.
I think if he got 35, he's a national frontrunner legitimately.
To your point about Amy, though, what's interesting is she has got to make up so much ground. Today, she announced her first campaign by ever.
You did hear what just happened there. So Chuck Todd says, well, you know, if he gets 35%, then he's the legitimate frontrunner. So if he doesn't get 35%, he's not the legitimate frontrunner, even if he wins? This is the double standard. Then there was the line in there that said, you know, Bernie Sanders, you know, they're going to say a win is a win. Well, guess what? A win is a win. And he won. They just won't give it to him. It's just mind-blowing. So this is the kind of shit that goes on over there. It is stunning. All right. Yesterday, we didn't start with a funny. Friday, we didn't start with a funny. So today I want to give you a funny and we'll start. I've got a couple that I can share with you today. Our friend Boca Brittany Summers has through the years produced a lot of bits about one drug addled Tubble Lard who broadcasts from his home in Palm Beach, Florida. He's a good friend of Donald Trump's. And last week, he announced that he's suffering from lung cancer. And again, I'm not one to wish illness or bad things on anybody. But as a lung cancer survivor, I somehow felt entitled to weigh in on the fact that Rush Limbaugh is now saying he has, quote, advanced lung cancer. I'm guessing that means stage four, but that's not a technical medical term. I was lucky. I had stage 1B lung cancer. We caught it really early. They removed the lower left lobe or the lower lobe of my left lung and did what's called a wedge resection of the upper left lobe of my lung because I had two separate and distinct tumors. I had two lung cancer tumors that were not related. The worry was that they were related, in which case it would have meant that it metastasized and spread if the two were related, but they were two separate and distinct cancerous tumors. So they cut out the lower lobe because that was where the bigger one was and took a chunk out of the upper lobe to cut out that tumor. And here we are, you know, almost 4 years later and I'm cancer-free. So that's good. But because I went through that, I don't know. It's still not right to wish illness on anyone. And I don't. I didn't wish illness on him. But you know what? If someone's got to get lung cancer, I can't think of anyone more deserving than Rush Limbaugh. But what Donald Trump did during the State of the Union address is, to me, is just sickening, is nauseating. Because we know who Rush Limbaugh is. He is a drug-addled, misogynist, homophobe, you know, I could go on. I should have written a long list of things to describe Rush Limbaugh. But instead of that, I thought I'd play you one of the bits that Boca Brittany Summers put together. So take it away, Britt.
Rush is a junkie head.
Oh, no, that was prescribed medication.
Rush is a junkie head.
Oh, that was medication for my back pain.
You go.
Down in 5,000 pills a day. Getting high till he melts his face. Uber right won't put him away. Rush is a junkie. Rush is a junkie.
It brings me up, it brings me down. It's a whole lot better than Milltown. I got so high that I would float till rehab placed one toe firmly back on moral ground.
Rush is a junkie. Rush is a junkie.
I'm off to your Melinda.
Rush is a junkie. Boca Brittany Summers. And you know what? Because that was so good, let's do another one. Take it away, Britt.
Well, you know, my friends, I've been asked many times how other on-air personalities can get fined or dismissed pretty much every time they open their mouth. Well, let me tell you, my friends, when you are the voice of corporate America in the White House, well, my friends, anything you say is deemed appropriate. Why? Ask the cop on the corner. Ask the cop on any street. Go ahead, ask him. What makes Rush Limbaugh great? Then douse him with precious gasoline and set the cop on fire. Hee-hee! And while you're at it, set the patrol car on fire, too! I represent the essence of homespun American morality, my friends. So I want you to go out there and paint graffiti that says, Rape Mothers of Dead Soldiers.
Oh, my God.
Now, I don't often have guests in the EIB studios, my friends, but I owe props to the one who appointed me your conscience. Welcome to the microphone, Jesus.
Hi, Jesus here.
Welcome to the EIB network. Now, as you can see on my subscription-only webcam, my friend, he does indeed resemble Peter O'Toole.
Well, a younger, more sober version, I hope, but not quite as gay.
Yes, you have the blonde hair and blue eyes, not the lefties version of Asian black. Why, all you need, my friend, is a pair of pants.
I never liked wearing pants.
Oh, here, try mine.
No, please. I don't like wearing pants.
Oh, very well, then. If you insist on being a transvestite, I guess you could do whatever you want.
That doesn't necessarily mean...
Say it with me now, my friends. Proud to be Republican filth.
No.
Tadalot, tadalot, proud to be Republican filth.
Tadalot,
tadalot, tadalot. Oh, look at that time. I've got to get to Denny's.
All right, just a couple of little ditties from our pal Boca Brittany Summers. You can hear Britt's own show at The Britt Summers Show, the BRITSOMERS show.com. She does a weekly program that airs on a number of different stations and, of course, on her own website. Thank you, Britt. We needed that today. And you know what? Ugh. Rush Limbaugh. The Medal of Freedom no longer means anything because during the State of the Union, if I didn't say it before, Trump awarded it to him. One of the most heinous excuses for a human being, certainly in my industry. I can't think of many more radio personalities more vile than Rush Limbaugh. So there you go. All right. There's news. There's a lot of news. Oh, my God. What a day yesterday was. So I'll tell you what. Let's do what's news. I've got an extended version for you today, and I'm not going to do it live today because coming up in a few minutes later, we're going to, you know, while we were for so long, we would check in the UK with our friend Denis Campbell, our American expatriate friend who lives over in the UK now, on what was going on over there with all the Brexit craziness. And then we got mired down in the impeachment. So while they were going through Brexit, we were in the throes of impeaching Donald Trump. So there was just too much going on, so I couldn't check in with Denis Campbell. We'll fix that today. And even before we get to, that's right, never forget Sandra Fluke. Thank you, Carne Verde, in the YouTube chat room. What Donald Trump did to her and other women is just, I mean, I'm sorry, Rush Limbaugh. Rush Limbaugh, Donald Trump, they're one and the same. Ugh. Skin crawl time. Anyway, we're going to check in with Denis Campbell in a little bit. I've got a Jonathan Pye bit to share with you on Brexit before we get Denis on the line. But before we get to any of that, well, it's time for What's News, because, oh my goodness, there's a lot of news.
I read the news today, oh boy.
It's time for Nicole Sandler's What's News from NicoleSandler.com and the Progressive Voices Network.
This victory here is the beginning of the end for Donald Trump.
The first in the nation primary election of the 2020 presidential race is in the history books. And Bernie Sanders is the winner. He began his victory speech noting that no matter who emerges as the nominee, all of them will band together to defeat Donald Trump.
And tonight I want to take the opportunity to express my appreciation and respect for all of the Democratic candidates we ran against. Pete Buttigieg, Amy Klobuchar, Elizabeth Warren, Joe Biden, and what I can tell you with absolute certainty, and I know I speak for every one of the Democratic candidates, is that no matter who wins, and we certainly hope it's going to be us, we are going to unite together. We are going to unite together and defeat the most dangerous president in the modern history of this country.
You go, Bernie. And you know what? Let me pause it here, because Bernie, that was one of the first things he said in his victory speech last night. He praised the other candidates and he said, no matter who wins, we're going to band together. We're going to defeat Donald Trump. And yet the media, the MSNBCs and the CNNs of the world, both keep demeaning him. They badmouth him. They talk down about him. They ignore him. And just, I want you to hear how Bernie has comported himself, because he's a straight up, straight shooter, good guy, the most honest man in the race, and honorable as well. Okay, sorry. Back to you, Nicole. This is found Bernie Sanders with a 6,000 vote lead in the popular vote. Yet somehow that put him 1/10 of a percentage point behind Pete Buttigieg in what they call state delegate equivalents. The former South Bend, Indiana mayor was awarded 13 delegates to Bernie's 12.
Yeah, right.
And in New Hampshire, as of 5 a.m. Eastern Time Wednesday morning, with 87% of the votes in, Bernie Sanders leads Buttigieg by 3,618 votes, or 1.3%, yet they both emerge with 9 delegates. If what? This isn't an argument to scrap the delegate electoral college system and move to a national popular vote, I don't know what is. Amy Klobuchar surged to a third place finish with 19.8%, and she gains 6 delegates. Elizabeth Warren placed 4th and Joe Biden 5th with 9.3% and 8.4% respectively, neither meeting the 15% threshold required for any delegates. And that's kind of sad. It's really sad, actually. Elizabeth Warren, I don't know why she fell apart. But, you know, I hope she stages a bit of a comeback, because I'd hate to see her out of the race. If she does exit the race, I certainly hope she teams up with Bernie Sanders. Anyway, back to you. The New Hampshire race also signaled the end of the campaign trail for both Andrew Yang and Michael Bennett. Keep in mind that primary season is now in full swing. In many states, if you want to vote in the Democratic primary, you must register as a Democrat. And lots of deadlines are fast approaching. In Florida and Arizona, February 18th is the last day to register to participate in the March 17th primary. The deadline is February 17th in Ohio and Alabama, February 24th in Michigan, February 25th in Georgia, and Wednesday, February 12th is the last day to register to vote in the primaries in Massachusetts.
Hello.
Bottom line, don't wait. Register today, and if you're already registered, double check just to make sure you haven't been purged from the voter rolls. Now, if not for the New Hampshire primary, the lead story everywhere on Wednesday would concern Michael Morando, Jonathan Kravis, Aaron Zelinsky, and Adam Jed. Those are the names of the 4 prosecutors who all withdrew from the legal proceedings against Roger Stone on Tuesday. Here's what happened. On Monday, career DOJ prosecutors said that Stone, Trump's longtime friend and advisor, deserved a lengthy prison term and recommended a 7 to 9 year sentence. In response, the orange one took to Twitter after midnight to complain, quote, "This is a horrible and very unfair situation. The real crimes were on the other side, as nothing happens to them. Cannot allow this miscarriage of justice." Then on Tuesday, less than 24 hours after the prosecutors announced their sentencing recommendation, reports surfaced that the DOJ told a federal judge that its earlier recommendation, quote, does not accurately reflect the Department of Justice's position, and asked the judge to impose a sentence that was, quote, far less. A few hours later, Aaron Zelinsky, the lead prosecutor, officially resigned from his position as Special Assistant U.S. Attorney in D.C. Then a second prosecutor in the Stone case, Jonathan Kravis, announced his resignation as an assistant U.S. attorney, leaving government altogether. Then Adam Jed became the third to withdraw, and just 2 hours after Zelinsky resigned, the 4th and final Stone prosecutor, Michael Morando, also withdrew. So the Department of Justice's new sentencing memo was signed only by John Crabb Jr., the acting head of the criminal division at the U.S. Attorney's Office in D.C.
No, I didn't speak to the judge. I'd be able to do it if I wanted. I have the absolute right to do it. I stay out of things.
Oh, my God.
To a degree that people wouldn't believe.
That's right. We don't believe it.
The DOJ only makes sentencing recommendations. The judge gets to make the final ruling on sentencing. In this case, the judge is the highly respected Amy Berman Jackson, who was appointed to the U.S. District Court for the District of Columbia by former President Barack Obama. To refresh your memory, Stone was convicted in November on 7 counts, including lying to Congress, witness tampering, and obstructing the House investigation into whether the Trump campaign coordinated with Russia to alter the 2016 elections. Oh, the White House also announced Tuesday that it was yanking Jesse Liu's nomination for a top Treasury post. Liu was previously the U.S. Attorney for D.C., overseeing not only the Stone prosecution, but also those of Andrew McCabe, Paul Manafort, and Michael Flynn, and she was due to testify next week. Now, if all of that wasn't authoritarian-y enough for you, Trump also said on Tuesday that the military will likely look at disciplinary action against Lieutenant Colonel Alexander Vindman, just days after the National Security Council official was ousted from the White House after giving damaging testimony during the House impeachment hearings. And if you're wondering what's next if Donald Trump should somehow manage to win re-election, consider this. Mysterious radio signals from outer space have been known to repeat, but for the first time, researchers have noticed a pattern in a series of bursts coming from a single source 500 million light years from Earth. Between September 16, 2018 and October 30, 2019, researchers detected a pattern in bursts coming every 16.35 days. And that's just a bit of what's news for now. I'm Nicole Sandler. If you appreciate these reports and the Nicole Sandler Show, I hope you'll consider making a contribution. My work is 100% listener supported, and I can't do it without your help. Find out more at NicoleSandler.com. And please click on that donate button. So, a couple of things to update from that What's News segment. Deval Patrick, former governor of Massachusetts, in case you didn't know, was technically running for president, too. I don't think he got anything in New Hampshire yesterday. And so he ended his campaign today. You needed to know that. People are going, who? Yeah, him. And in terms of registering to vote, the site that I used, and it was Business Insider, which has a chart for the different states and when you have to, the deadline to register to be able to vote in the primary. This one said, and I only gave out the deadlines in February, but someone in the chat room said New York only has like 3 days left. However, according to this site, it says April 3rd. So act like it is this week. Act like you only have 2 days. If you're not registered to vote yet, do it now. You can usually register to vote online. Go just look up your state's Secretary of State office. The state Secretary of State, I believe, is who, or Division of Elections or Supervisor of Elections for your county. Any of those should get you the information on registering. Don't wait until the deadline. And again, if you think you are registered, double check, because a lot of these red states are purging voters left and right. So make sure your registration is still valid and do it before those deadlines. In fact, don't wait for the deadlines. Do it now. Okay. So John Doe is asking, any way we can hear and see that outer space signal? I don't think so. So here's the story that I just ended What's News with, and I find it fascinating. A mysterious radio signal from outer space is repeating every 16 days. Now, they say that radio signals from space have been known to repeat, but this is the first time that researchers have noticed a pattern in the series of bursts coming from a single source 500 million light years away. So it went on for a little over a year Between September 16, 2018 and October 30, 2019, researchers detected a pattern in bursts occurring every 16.35 days. I could, you know, I go into a Twilight Zone kind of mode, and I imagine alien creatures in their spaceship observing us and going, what a bunch of fucking idiots these Earthlings are. Oh my God, look what they're doing in the United States. They've elected Donald Trump. And oh my goodness, look over in Great Britain. They elected Trump's counterpart in Boris Johnson. These Earthlings are going to kill themselves. They're going to blow this planet up. So we'll keep an eye out. We'll get close. And maybe, maybe when, you know, they're on the verge of self-destruction, we'll go in and, you know, we'll take a few. Maybe that'll be the rapture. Maybe this spaceship will beam the good guys up, you and me, and leave Trump and Limbaugh and Don Imus and the rest of these miscreants to, you know, reap what they sow here on Earth. A girl can dream, can't she? All right. In a few minutes, we're gonna call over to the UK. We're going to talk to Denis Campbell, find out what's been going on over there, because they did Brexit. Yes, they did. The end of January, they exited the European Union. So we'll find out what that's all about. But before we go there, Jonathan Pye has been quite busy. For those of you who aren't familiar, Jonathan Pye is a British fake newsman. And he makes these videos. You just find him on YouTube, Jonathan Pye. In fact, he's got a fake news tour coming up. I don't know if he's touring the US or just the UK. But what his shtick is, he does these stand-up, you know, hits, ostensibly for a British television station. So he does the setup at a location outside of Buckingham Palace or a Parliament or wherever he might be. So he does the setup. And then while they go to the videotape for the taped actual so-called report, Jonathan Pye basically rants to the cameraman about what's on his mind. And then as the video news report that's allegedly playing on the television station ends, they cut back to Jonathan Pye to wrap it up, and it fades to black. So keeping that in mind, here's Jonathan Pye on Brexit.
At 10 p.m., the Prime Minister will hail the start of a new era. And at 11 p.m. tonight, we will no longer be members of the European Union. Oddly enough, we actually leave at midnight on Brussels time. Here's the latest. So here we go. That's it. Sort of. The start of a new era. An era of utter irrelevance on the international stage. Yay! A new era as the Tories end austerity by introducing further cuts to public spending. Yay! No change here, mate. Just more lies. There's a strange atmosphere here, Tim. So it's kind of eerie, you know? What's odd is, in Westminster, there's still a few people holding signs up saying, stop Brexit! You can't! And what's more, you never could! Still a few people frantically waving EU flags. You know, I've never understood that. Can you remember at any point before the referendum, anyone ever waving an EU flag with pride, like the EU is some sort of woke utopia? You know, it's a trading bloc. It's a club for multinationals to play soggy biscuit. It's where the phrase millionaire's shortbread comes from, you know? And yet, anyone that dared to vote to leave it, you know, like in the 80s, when we were told not to sit on a loo seat in case you got AIDS, that's how most of the liberal elite have treated leave voters ever since the result. Don't touch them, you might turn racist. This week, you had Terry Christian on Good Morning Britain go, hi, all right, I'm Terry Christian. I reckon anyone who didn't vote the way I did deserves to live in abject poverty. And then we all wonder why Leave voters would rather vote for Boris than the people that we tell them to vote for. When you say shit like that, Terry, not only do you lose the moral high ground, you also lose the referendum. And you make Piers Morgan seem like a reasonable human being. And you sound like a twat. Oh, these 50 pence pieces are a disgrace. They don't represent my political views at all. Bam, these 50 pence pieces. If you don't like them, why not give it to someone queuing outside a food bank? You know, they can't afford to be fussy about their loose change. Hi, all right, I'm Terry Christian, and I'll only give you this 50 pence piece if you agree with me about everything. Fries my fucking noodle that there are people out there that still haven't got their head around the result of years ago, you know? It took me about 48 hours. I still sometimes see Trump in front of the seal of the President of the United States, and still, 4 years later, I'm like, how can this fat, lobotomized sexual predator possibly have won the keys to the White House? But Brexit, I mean, I was as shocked as everyone else. Don't get me wrong. I was as shocked as David Cameron, the man who called the referendum and then banned civil servants from doing any preparation for if the country voted to leave, because, you know, what a waste of time that would have been. But, you know, after a couple of days, I thought, shit, it looks like we're leaving. We better get our act together. But we never have. We never did. And because of that, we now have the worst Brexit imaginable. We were told a trade deal with the EU would be the easiest in history. We don't have one. The Irish border question is still pretty much unanswered, really. Advice for businesses from the government this week was, well, whatever happens, you're just going to have to deal with it, all right? We were promised that leaving the EU wouldn't mean leaving the single market. Bollocks. What? All right, I'll tell you exactly who promised that to him. A guy called Boris fucking Johnson. You might have heard of him. The opportunistic liar who is now running the fucking country. The guy who got Brexit done. Yeah, and we are leaving the EU in the worst possible way, with a hard right, hard Brexit government in place, full of right-wing zealots who still secretly hope that we crash out without a deal, not because it's what's best for the country, but it's what's best for them and their political careers and their business interests and their bank balances. The start of a new era. Bastards. Well, just hours to go now. I was about to say before that the clock strikes 11, but no Big Ben bongs tonight. Not enough bobs were bunged, if I can get my teeth around that one. But later I will be at 10 p.m. The Prime Minister will hail the start.
Back again. Ah, this newfangled software. All right. Jonathan Pye, everyone. Quite brilliant, don't you think? I do. Again, find him. You can search for it. It's a fake news tour 2020 on sale now. Extra dates due to popular demand. I guess just Google Jonathan Pye. Again, I don't know if he's coming here or is just going to be in the UK, but I guess we'll find out soon enough. All right. I am... we're getting Denis Campbell on the line now. I'm dealing with some technical stuff on my end. Go figure. Me having technical problems. I don't know. So let's get Denis Campbell on the line. I think he's there. Hey, Denis, you there? Oh, hello.
Hello.
We don't. You said you have good sound now, but I'm really not hearing you.
Oh dear.
Oh, there you are. Not, I got you now. I got you now.
Okay. There you go. Sorry. Yeah. the gremlins are running around through the audio system here.
They are. Well, here too. So welcome to my world. So aren't we a fine sight? I don't know if you heard in What's News, the last story I did about this alien that's sending radio signals to the U.S. It was every 16.35 days for over a year. So there's a pattern out there. I think they're watching us and going, these earthlings are fucked up. And the evidence is right there with Donald Trump and Boris Johnson. Oh my goodness. I spoke to a friend this weekend who was telling me she's from the UK and she has dual citizenship. She said, I don't know which place is worse these days.
Yeah, we've lost the benefit of being part of a block of 28 European Union countries. now we were told just yesterday that the US and the UK trade deal is probably not as high a priority for the United States as the US EU trade deal. Right. So now we, you know, could be at the end of the year with no trade deal with the United States, no trade deal with the European Union. And a very big challenger bank here has over 200,000 customers based in Berlin, has just decided that it's going to be way too difficult to try and deal with the United Kingdom that's not part of the European Union. So they've basically told those 200,000 customers that they have, 6 months in which to find another bank. They're not going to open accounts in the United Kingdom because there's just too much hassle involved with it. But we got a coin.
You got a coin. But now is there, I understood that for like at least the next year, the average Brit is not going to see much of a difference. Is that true?
That's true. I mean, the deal that went into effect on the 31st, the magic day of January, is one that basically was the acceptance of Article 50 saying we are leaving the European Union. Now, the big issue that everybody's looking at is what are we going to do in terms of a final Brexit deal, trade deals, customs sorting, all the things that need to be done. And of course, this being a hard right Tory government, they're basically making it impossible for the European Union to strike any deal. So we still could crash out on the 31st of December when all the singing and dancing is done with no deal whatsoever. A lot of work has been put in to make certain that, you know, people with foreign passports have what's known as permanent right to remain. And, only a few have done it from certain countries, and nobody's knowing if any of that's going to be reciprocal in any other country in the European Union. And, you know, Boris and his minions are just behaving like assholes. No better word.
Well, welcome to our world, because this is what we've been living with for the last 3.5 years. So Denis Campbell, when Brexit actually happened, it was January 31st, right?
Yeah, it was went out with a whimper.
Yeah, all this time and the big buildup, and they couldn't get their shit together to Brexit when it was first supposed to happen, and it was delayed again and again, and then it happened, and it was just like, all right, we're gone.
Basically, yeah. I mean, yeah, I think what happened is that, you know, like everything else, people were just fatigued. They were exhausted. Mm. You know, we couldn't fight it anymore. We didn't have a majority. I mean, Boris has an 80-seat majority, an 80-vote majority in the House of Commons. So anything he wants to do gets done, including this stupid high-speed railway, which was originally budgeted at £5 billion, about $7 or $8 billion US dollars, to build this line all the way up into the north, up into Scotland. And it's now approaching a price tag of more like £84 to £89 billion. And it doesn't touch Wales. It doesn't touch a lot of different people. And it's only good for whisking people through the north and up into Scotland and back down again without any other points in between, because it's almost impossible once you get into northern England to travel by train east to west or west to east, because the lines just don't exist. So it's this boondoggle and folly that if we brought the Chinese over, we'd get it done in 6 weeks, you know, but of course they just don't want to do that. And the way the workers work on rail lines, I mean, they do nice work, but it just takes flipping forever.
Sure. And in the meantime, I mean, there are social programs that are going to be hurting, right? But due to lack of funds. Now, when the whole Brexit campaign was going on before the vote, I guess I should call it propaganda, because that's what it was. It turned out to be lies. But the pro-Brexit people were saying all the money we'll save that we, you know, have to send to the European Union every month, instead, we'll put that all into the National Health Service. That was a lie.
That lie was debunked on election evening.
Wow.
Believe it or not. You know, they had the battle bus that went around the country all the way back now in 2016, May of 2016. So we're coming up on 4 years of this malarkey, I'll use that word, and nonsense that they've been going through. Mm-hmm. And, you know, 4 years of fighting, and we still ended up, you know, with a lost election because, you know, Jeremy Corbyn just badly misrepresented and misunderstood the mood of the country. And now we're stuck with this majority that's almost as big as the one Margaret Thatcher had. And she did so much good for the country. Ask any coal miner what their life has been
like
since.
Sarcasm. Just
I'm just letting people know. We do need, like, on Twitter, a sarcasm button there.
Right. So, but Dennis, okay, I'm glad you brought up Jeremy Corbyn, because the right-wingers are screaming about Bernie Sanders, of course, now being in the lead. He won the first in the nation primary last night in New Hampshire. He got the most votes by 6,000 in Iowa, but thanks to our fucked up system over here. Pete Buttigieg, who, again, got 6,000 fewer votes than Bernie did, somehow came 1/10 of a percentage point ahead of Bernie in the delegate estimate, or whatever they call it, the state delegate estimate or something like that, the SDE, that determines how many delegates they get. And again, Bernie had 6,000 more votes. Mayo Pete squeaked out or eked out a win by 1/10 of a percentage point in terms of the state delegate estimates or whatever. And he winds up with one more delegate than Bernie does. You know, it is FUBAR. It just makes no fucking sense whatsoever.
It never has. And, you know, that's the problem when you have 57, basically, elections for delegates to the Democratic National Convention, is that every state makes up its rules. Some do a very simple first-past-the-post distribution. Others create these convoluted structures. And I think, you know, there's a fundamental flaw here. And I like Bernie as a person, but he's got to join the flipping party if he wants to be the standard bearer for it and benefit from all of the funding and everything else that goes with it. So,
you know, yes,
you've got so many issues here.
Yeah, in this instance, I actually agree with you. I love Bernie. He's my candidate. You can see all the Bernie stickers behind me. Elizabeth Warren, my second choice. I hurt last night when I saw how she had fallen. And Amy Klobuchar, a woman who wants to bring anti-choicers into our big tent, who believes bipartisanship comes above progressive values. I mean, she would be horrible. I'm sorry, if she gets the nomination, I guess I would do what I did last year and pull out my industrial strength nose clips and vote for her. But I certainly don't want her. Bernie Sanders is the leading candidate. But there, people have a problem with the Democratic Socialist label, even though we know what he's talking about. He's talking about the Denmark version, the Germany, the healthcare for everyone kind of socialism, Canadian, British kind of healthcare. But, you know, all they hear, what we're hearing over here on a daily basis, is socialism is communism because people are fucking stupid here because a college education is so expensive, I guess.
Well, and the thing is that, you know, the priorities that have been placed in the United States in governance have been in the military industrial complex and not in the care of people. Mm-hmm. Now, you can call me a socialist, you can call my country socialist, but there is a fundamental guiding principle, and that is we take care of each other.
Yeah.
You know, you're not going to see people. And I said this, 2 years ago at the thing that Bob put together, Rob Abstin, in Florida, the big healthcare system. You're not going to see people in the United Kingdom going bankrupt because they can't pay a medical bill.
Right.
And you'll see them going bankrupt because they do stupid things financially, right, but not because they, you know, have, you know, had the poor fortune of becoming ill. Now, the thing that most people in the United States have the biggest difficulty with is the idea that the acute, really serious cases get taken care of first, and then it becomes a fairly democratized process for anything else that comes along. So you have lists, you have waiting lists. Sometimes,
but guess what? You do here too. If I want to go see my primary care physician, I can't just go in because I don't feel well. The next appointment I can get is a month away. I need to see a specialist. I waited over 2 months to see my neurologist, and I deal with this restless leg syndrome, which is a neurological disorder. You have to wait here too. People act like that's not the case. That is the case.
And the prescription thing is just absolute insanity. Insane. And, you know, one of the things that, you know, has been rumored, but there's been nothing mentioned. We've had a couple of memos come out of Number 10 and other places saying that one of the things that Trump wants to ensure is that the UK pays more for prescription drugs than they currently do. Oh. And to do so, find a way to pass that on to consumers. Well, the way the NHS has worked is that if somebody shows up in need, they get taken care of. And one of the needs is medication. I mean, I did a calculation on the back of an envelope 2 years ago for that talk I gave down in Florida. Uh-huh. And I would be bankrupt with the number of pills and medical procedures I've had since 2016. I'm not going to go into the details of them. I did there because they would cost me absolutely more than I make. And I don't understand how anybody can be faced with a $500 per month bill for insulin going up to $5,000. And you said to yourself, wait, nobody is watching out and keeping track of what absolutely is actually happening here and making certain that people don't get left behind.
Right. Right. And is that, I mean, that's got to be a worry too, doesn't it? That you're going to start having to pay for things, that privatization is coming your way. This is a Donald Trump, Boris Johnson production, isn't it?
And others. I mean, there are other interests that want, you know, they're pieces of the pie since they're now in control. And, you know, the system right now is near the point of collapse, and coronavirus is not going to help either. By the way, it just flashed on the screen as we were talking here that that half of the, or more of the CDC kits that are being sent now to study have flaws in them. So accurate numbers and results of who has the coronavirus, if you can believe it or not, are not going to be known forever. But these all place a strain on our systems, and it's going to eventually hit the economy. We're not flying to China. China's not flying here.
Nope.
Commerce is not being conducted. And when it comes back, it'll come back slowly. And it's just a matter of time before other countries come forward and say, no flights to China, no flights anywhere, and put China-like clampdowns to stem the growth of this. I mean, I went to London yesterday and I was on a train and I was on the underground and I was on a bus, you know, and I'm keeping, again, I'm watching and I'm seeing everybody that's from the Orient is walking around with these paper masks over their faces. And you just, you wonder, I mean, by taking this business trip to London, am I somehow taking a risk to my own life?
Mm-hmm. Well, it's scary. You know, putting that aside, I've often thought what one thing this planet could probably use is a good plague. So maybe, you know, maybe we're there. I wish it would hit, you know, the White House. I know that's wrong for me to say, but I can't help it. Our lives have been destroyed. We have. So you were tied up in Brexit while we were tied up with this impeachment trial. You are an American. You're a dual citizen, Denis Campbell, right? Mm-hmm. So I'm sure you paid attention to some of it. Your feelings on what's going on over here right now? Because I'm terrified.
Well, I mean, the latest with the Justice Department just sort of basically saying, you know, the same as the president, you know, F you and everybody else.
That's right.
We're going to do this the way we want to do it. I think that's a massive, massive problem for just the rule of law and the foundations of democracy, because, you know, this guy is now absolutely unleashed, untethered, and untamed, and he is just going to do whatever he wants. I mean, yesterday in the press avail in the Oval, he basically said, "I have the power to do whatever I want to tell the Attorney General whatever I want him to do."
And the thing
and
is,
that,
he doesn't.
To me, is scary.
He's never obviously read the Constitution.
Right.
No surprise there, but nobody's ever explained to him what Article 2 says, because
if
he
you
believes.
If you explain it to him, you get fired.
Exactly. Anybody who crosses him, anybody who expresses criticism gets fired now. You're not allowed to speak poorly of the president. I was watching something. I can't remember what it was now. Oh, I know what it was. American Factory. It's the documentary that won the Oscar, produced by Barack and Michelle Obama's company for Netflix. So it tells the story of a factory in I want to say Michigan that went closed down. They did auto glass, shut down because we know all the factories in the U.S. shut down, and a Chinese company came over and reopened in the factory and brought over a lot of Chinese people and hired a bunch of Americans. But they were doing a cultural training, explaining to them how things are different here. And one of the things that the people seemed genuinely surprised about was, you are allowed to criticize the president. You're allowed to criticize the government. And people looked at each other like, whoa. you know what? You're not allowed to anymore because you do that and you're going to be the target.
In 2012, I took a media junket, was invited by China Radio International because I do a lot of commentary for them. Mm-hmm. And there were a dozen other journalists there with me. And we were taken out to Xinjiang province, which is in the far western part of the country. And, you know, most of the people we talked with, interviewed, are now in concentration camps. And, you know, so it is nasty, nasty stuff if you allow a dictator to grow into such a space of power that they're able to wield it in that way. I mean, Joe this morning was speculating that, you know, what would it be like if Trump felt he could put journalists in jail?
If
anybody that, you know, criticized or disagreed with him could be put in jail, that'd be the end of democracy, be the end of the country, be the end of the news media. So right. It's, you know, it's a real fear. But when we started to ask questions, the thing that surprised me the most was how brainwashed most of the people that were with CRI were about their country and their leaders and their system and because that's the way they're trained. They're literally inculcated almost from birth with this is the system. This is how we do it here. And it was frightening to a bunch of us that would sit in the cocktail bar and chat afterwards. And my God, can you believe the way, you know, Mi Ling reacted to what was said about da-da-da? And they get positively militant in defense of their leaders and their country. So it is scary, scary stuff.
It is. Everything is scary right now. We're living in really scary times. And, you know, some of us are not dealing with it very well. So here we are. Look, I'm uplifted by the fact that Bernie Sanders won last night, that he is the leading candidate. But we have the corporate media over here, MSNBC, CNN, hell, even PBS, telling us that, well, Bernie's not the real deal. In fact, I played a clip earlier of Chuck Toad from yesterday explaining that, you see, in 2016, Bernie Sanders won New Hampshire by 22 points. So he actually said the words, but the Democrats are going to say a win is a win. He's got to get 35% in order to legitimately be the front runner against 10 other candidates, where last time it was against one.
In 1988, when the Miami Heat came into the NBA, I was one of the statisticians for them. And, you know, we had a close game with the Utah Jazz, and Carl the Mailman Malone did his radio interview. And then he was walking by heading back to the locker room. And I said to him, hey, Mailman, pretty close there. And he looked at me with a stone cold face and said, W. And that was all that mattered. Now, for me, I'm not going to pay much attention to any of this media bullshit until after Super Tuesday.
Okay.
Because at that point, 45% of the delegates are awarded, and you know who the front runners are, and you know what's real and what's not. Right now,
right.
I mean, you think about this. This is the first election where we've really had this level of 24/7 media idiocracy, for lack of a better word, because they're just not paying attention. They've got to make everything into a horse race,
everything
into some sort of, and you've taken the two whitest, smallest states. I mean, would you have 20% turnout
in
Iowa?
Yeah.
20% turnout.
Horrible.
I mean, you had maybe 55% in New Hampshire.
Yep.
That's still not a mandate. That's still not what it's going to be like.
But that's
come the
that's
election
huge
day when
for
you're
here.
Down to two people.
Right.
Sorry?
Exactly. But that's huge. The 55% in New Hampshire is huge because
yeah, but it went down in the young people who like Bernie.
Yeah, that
so
man,
that
that's
says
disturbing.
Something to me. I mean, you we had a whole bunch of people that loved Jeremy Corbyn, but didn't turn out to vote for him. You know, it's they can't be arsed because they're on their phones, they're playing their Spotify list, they're in Candy Crush or on Instagram or
mm-hmm.
whatever,
mm-hmm.
and they don't understand because they've never seen how serious the threat actually is.
Right. Hey, Dennis, I got to back up for a second because
sure.
John Doe in the chat room asked the question. I'm thinking, what's W? What do you mean W?
Win.
When you were talking about
Carl the Mailman Malone said W.
Right. What does that
means,
mean?
Hey, it was a win, you idiot.
Oh.
And it doesn't matter how big or how small it is. It was a win.
Okay. Well, and
that's what he meant. Yeah.
And
sorry, I apologize for not making that clear.
That's okay. Well, I'm glad.
It was Bush.
Yeah.
Trust me.
That's what I was wondering. It's like George. Yeah, he's what's wrong with you know, a lot. So everything is a mishmash over here. Yeah. We're you know, but you're right. So we have Nevada coming up next week, and then South Carolina,
which is a caucus.
Yes, which is a caucus.
And caucuses are messy.
Stupid. They're stupid.
Democracy is messy. Stupid.
Right. And then, then South Carolina. And after South Carolina, then it's Super Tuesday. And I agree with you. After Super Tuesday, that's when it's time to shit or get off the pot. And I think then we'll be narrowed down to whatever it is. I guess we wait and see. I'd be lying if I didn't say I was concerned.
Oh, I'm concerned, but, you know, it's just a matter of time. You know, they're going to figure it out.
The
voters will get it right. They eventually do.
No, they don't. Well, they do, but we people will disagree with me. I fight with my friend Brad Friedman about this a lot. I believe the DNC is doing everything they can to keep Bernie Sanders from getting the nomination.
Well, I've got my Dump Trump, Keep America Great t-shirt on tonight.
Well, thank you for that. Denis Campbell, when is your primary? When is the Americans Living Abroad primary happen?
I don't know. I vote in the state of Tennessee, for Super Tuesday. I already cast my ballot about 3 weeks ago and posted it.
Oh, good. Oh. Good.
Yeah, Americans Abroad is almost the same time, because I think they tried to do it, because I remember reading some things, because my kids are old enough to vote for the first time.
Oh, nice. Mine so, too. This will be her first. I got it to real quickly. This will be her first presidential election. She's 20 now. And so our ballots came in the mail on Monday. David and I filled ours out immediately. Bernie Sanders, you got it. Last night I said to Allison, you got to fill out your ballot. I said, do you know who you're voting for? And she goes, I'm not sure yet. She goes, I'm thinking maybe Elizabeth Warren. And I said, good for you. I love hearing that. But I said, don't fill your ballot out yet. Because our primary.
My first ballot was for John Anderson.
Oh, boy. Well, mine was, who did I vote? I voted against Ronald Reagan. Ronald Reagan was elected president on my 21st birthday. This is my legacy. Thank you so much.
I didn't
know
you were a Scorpio as well.
I am November 4th. So November 4th this year is the day after Election Day. We know what November 9th was like in 2016. Please make this a happy birthday for me on November 4th.
Yeah, and I'm on the 13th, so I'll celebrate in your honor if it's a good news.
Sounds good. All right, Denis Campbell, I'm already running long, so I'm going to let you go. Good luck to us all, I guess, is what I say here, right?
God save us one and all.
One and all. Thank you so much, Denis Campbell. Find him on the Twitters at ClientLoyaltyDC. Denis Campbell here on the Nicole Sandler Show. Thank you, Denis. Always great to talk with you.
Pleasure.
Bye-bye. All right, and with that, we are done. We've come to the end of another show. And I'll say what I said to Denis. Good luck to us all. Tomorrow's Thursday. Howie Klein will be here. Friday, we'll end the week with Tom Hartman. And, of course, the latest news and everything else that's going on in the world. Thank you for being here. If you got a couple extra bucks to spare, I could certainly use it. Go to NicoleSandler.com, click on that donate button, and peruse the website. There's so much content on there. There's writing. There's interviews. There's music stuff. There's a ton of stuff, and it's all free. You know, we're honor system, donation only. So whatever you can do to help us out, I appreciate it. I hope you enjoy. And with that, I'll see you tomorrow. Thanks, everyone. And I guess I'll just say, keep the faith. And aliens, if you're up there, come beam me up. I'm ready. All right. I'll see you tomorrow, everyone. Bye.